everyone. Welcome to the first day of qualitative analysis with NEVO. Before we start hardcore qualitative analysis, which we will start today, I would want to tell you first what is qualitative data. So what I'm going to explain over here in the next 1 hour before we touch base with NEVO is that what are the types of qualitative data that you can analyze in NEVO, and what is the use of taking those qualitative data to NEVO. So that is exactly what I'm about to start. First thing first, what is that research design where we do qualitative data? So the research design where we go for a qualitative data is known as the exploratory research design. In descriptive research design, what we do is we have numbers, we quantify. But in exploratory research design, what we do is we try to explore and find a new variable. So many a times when we are working with, suppose, one construct or one variable, for example, I am finding out all the factors which affect sustainable purchase intention. Now, if I see the previous theories, there are factors which affect intention, but there are very few which talk about sustainable purchase intention. Now, here there is a gap and I have no paper which is talking about sustainable purchase intention. So what do? I go for exploration. What is exploration? I will be the first one who will find out a construct named sustainable purchase intention. Also, I could do it the other way. For example, I have a construct called sustainable purchase intention, but I do not know what are the factors which affect it. So I try to find out all the factors which are going to impact the sustainable purchase intention. I could do it in two ways. One is through exploration, in which I go through personal interviews, focus group interviews, ethnography, all the data collection which is involved in qualitative data. And I finally say, okay, these are my items, these are my constructs. Another way of doing it is going through descriptive study. There what I do is, I list all the factors which are presently affecting purchase intention and say, okay, this is my model. I will collect a data of somewhere around 500 samples, do a descriptive study, or do a causal study and prove that model fit. Now we are going to work on the first approach, which is exploration. So exploration is a type of research design where the information is loosely defined. I'll really explain what this means. The findings are tentative, okay? And further, a conclusive, or what we call descriptive research, is needed to say that, okay, this finding is now final. For example, there was a research done by a researcher on what happens after death. So it was very difficult for him. Now imagine, this is exploration. Why I call it exploration is because nobody has ever worked on it. He was the first person who was working on it. Number one. Number two, he did not have a pre-described construct called what happens after death. He did not have a standard authored scale or items for a construct called what happens after death. He did not have anything like this. He did not even have past studies. The only past studies he had probably would have been studies which talk of, say, mythology, okay, or religious studies. That is the only base he had. He had never actually seen what happens after death. So what did he do? He took a sample of people who were declared dead by the doctor and then came up to life after 5 minutes. So I repeat, he took a sample of people, which was a very small sample. And by the way, when you're doing an exploratory research, because there is no past review, we can say that even with a small sample of, say, 30 to 40 people being interviewed, you could give a very good exploratory research output. So what he did is he went to somewhere around 20 to 30 people who had been declared dead. They had been declared dead by the doctors, but then they came up to life after 5 minutes. He interviewed these people and asked them what happened after death. He did a personal interview. He consolidated the findings and finally concluded 2-3 things of what people see after death. Now, this whole example that I've given you is an exploratory research, but there was no predefined theory over here. Okay, he made up a theory of his own. And this can only and only be done, this exploration can only and only be done by qualitative research. But for the same, when I collect data through personal interviews, through videos, through audios, I have to know how to analyze it and reach to the construct. I have to know how to analyze it and reach to the items. I have to know how to analyze it and reach a theory. A conceptual theory, when you say making a conceptual theory, it is not just taking review from all sides and just consolidating it. That is summarizing a theory. That is not making up your own theory. That is just summarizing what people have done. So exploration helps you to make new items, new scales, new constructs, new theories, and even theories on something that has never been studied as good as what happens after death. Now, what are the methods of exploration, or what are the data collection methods or research methods for qualitative analysis? So all this you'll have to do before you come to NVivo. So before you come to NVivo, you'll have to say that you had an exploratory research design, and then these are the ways I collected data. And each of these can be analyzed in NVivo. So the first type of data collection that we do is through secondary data. Okay, so the first type of data collection that I do is research papers. So we can import research papers into NVivo. We can import past review of literature papers. Okay, it is imported, and then I will do something called a line-to-line coding or something called an open coding. I'll tell you what it is when I go to NVivo. But here, what is the input of my qualitative data? It is secondary data. Okay, it is secondary data. So even if I was to make a conceptual model, I don't want to do a personal interview. I do not want to do a personal interview. I don't want to do an empirical study. What is an empirical study? Where I have a primary data, be it quantitative or qualitative. So even when you are going to a sample and you are doing a personal interview, that is empirical study. But suppose I don't want to do an empirical study, I don't want to go to the sample, I just want to analyze all the concepts that have been explained by the past researchers. Even that can be done in NVivo. All the data that you have over here will be past research papers. Okay, so rather than having 10 personal interviews, here I will input into NVivo 10 secondary data papers or 10 research papers for my particular topic, and I will analyze them. Okay, so this is the first type of analysis, the input that can go into NVivo. The second type of input which can be collected is projective techniques. Now, projective techniques we generally do, I'll just read it out for you. Respondents project their underlying motivations or beliefs. We generally do this when we are working with brands. So if there is a brand called Versace, which is a luxury brand, and I want to know what is the attitude of a person towards it, or if it's a simple thing like when burgers came to India, so people had a belief, you know, that burgers cannot be lunch. Burgers cannot be lunch. We were so used to our wheat breads and our rice that we said that no, burgers cannot be lunch. So there were times when, companies like McDonald's were doing a projective technique. Now, what is projection? Projection is you would give the sample a picture, or you would give a sample a sentence, or you would give a sample a word and say, think, make a picture in your mind about it. Now, based on the picture he makes in his mind, we can actually, position our brand. We can sell our product, we can bring in new products, all that can happen on the basis of the picture the consumer makes of the product. Now, suppose I catch hold of a consumer and say, okay, make a picture, when you hear the word bingo, let me do a word association. When you hear the word bingo, what comes to your mind? So when he is thinking, he will say, okay, crazy stuff, silly stuff, funny, comical. Some may say Ranveer Singh. So n number of things are coming. Now all these things that are coming to his mind, we will consolidate, put it into a word file and give it to NVivo. And we will have to do the coding part. The coding part has to be done with every sort of research. So it has to be done with secondary data. It has to be done with projective techniques. For all the type of qualitative data that I'm telling you, for all of this coding will be done, right? So what is being done in NVivo will be done on all these techniques. So now I have two. I can take in secondary data, which means I can take review papers. I can take in projective techniques. So if there are any word association tests being done on a sample of 100 people on what they feel about bingo, I can take all that data and put it into NVivo and analyze. Mind you, qualitative analysis is only and only and only text analysis. No numbers at all. I repeat, qualitative analysis is only and only text analysis. Words, paragraphs, sentences, feelings, emotions. They have nothing to take with numerical data. We don't have numeric data at all in qualitative analysis. The next type of technique would be ethnography. Now, ethnography is a technique where a researcher actually goes and lives with the people to understand their culture, their themes, etc. Now, why do we in management need ethnography? We need ethnographies because, again, if I take an example of a brand called Versace and it has to come to India, it has to actually study the Indian culture. So where brands like Brunello Cucinelli, luxury brands like those have camel color sweatshirts or camel color cardigans in their whole portfolio, when they come to India, they will have to study the culture, and when they study the culture, they come to know, oh my God, Indians are more towards colors. So Indians are a set of people who would like a red cardigan or a yellow cardigan, and they change. Now, how do they come across this? How do they come across these findings? They do something called ethnography. Ethnography is a study of cultures, their themes. And for doing so, it means you live with them at least for 6 months. At least for 6 months. Now, there is a concern in ethnography. One being that do you tell them that you're a researcher or not? Ideally, you should not tell them. Because how this is different from a personal interview is that you're living with them and you're not letting them know that you are a researcher. And you write scripts and diaries and narratives about their life. Bring back, put it in NVivo and analyze it. Okay, this was invented by Bronislaw Malinowski in 1915. He spent somewhere around 3 years in Trobriand Island. And he studied their culture, he lived with them, brought back narratives, and then analyzed them. Of course, in 1915, they did not analyze it on NVivo because at that time, a very manual analysis used to be done. The next type of research data that you can bring is case study. Case study has been made famous by the Harvard Business School, of course. And it is a very, very good way of qualitative research. It is used in explanatory, exploratory studies and even descriptive studies. But in exploratory studies, how do we analyze cases is that we take a company, study its profit and loss, see how it ventured through 10 years, again, make a narrative, a descriptive, and then bring it to NVivo and analyze it. But a case study is one which can only be done on one sample. For example, if you see the picture on the slide, this man is known as Phineas Gage. And there was a doctor who studied and who related personality to brain. Okay, and how did he come to that theory of relating personality to brain is by this one case study. So this one man was a person called Phineas Gage, and a 0.8 mm rod went through his brain, and this man was very conscious, and he comes to the doctor, he's speaking about his accident, he's very much conscious, he's not dead, he should have been dead, but he was not dead. So he's speaking to the doctor, He is narrating what happened to him. He memorizes what had happened to him. He remembered everything. And after the doctor treated him, where it took somewhere around 6 months to treat him, after that, the doctor followed him for quite a period of time to see the personality changes which had come to him because his brain was damaged. So before that, nobody knew. When they spoke of personality, they only spoke about the physical characteristics. So this was one case study. And mind you, case study can be done even on one subject. So just imagine if the doctor had to wait for another Phineas Gage. Another Phineas Gage would have never come into his life. Rather, he was one of the lucky doctors who got a case study like Phineas Gage, and he could understand personality through brain. Other doctors did not even get that chance. Okay, so this is what is a case study. Can be done on one person also. Generally, when you see research papers, qualitative research papers on case studies, it is generally done on either one company or maximum 2 to 3 companies. And those 2 to 3 companies are similar. So there is something similar they are comparing in the case studies. Okay, this is the most common method of qualitative analysis, which I think everybody knows, personal interviews and focus group interviews. So when you do a personal interview, it is a one-to-one interview. When you do a focus interview, you have some 8-10 people speaking on a topic. Depends on what's your research objective, which approach you take. But whichever approach you take, now I will be also, analyzing interviews in N vivo today. So whichever approach you take, and when you analyze this, it is called content analysis. It is also called narrative analysis. Okay, these are similar things. Content analysis, narrative analysis, thematic analysis. All these three things are similar. Rather, thematic analysis is more general. All that coding that I'm telling you, which we are about to do in N vivo, for all these types of research is called thematic analysis. Okay, now content analysis or narrative qualitative study means I have a set theory. I have a set theory, so I say attitude affects intention. This theory is fixed. This theory has been given in past literature. I want to find out if Indians are tally with this theory or not. There is no research done as yet on Indians whether their attitude affects purchase intention or not, and that is what I want to do. Here, I will do a personal interview of some, say, 30 to 40 Indians. And I will collect that content and I will see if attitude is affecting intention or not. But in content analysis, we have to, whenever you're writing a research paper which has content analysis, personal interview, content analysis done through personal interview or focus group, you have to make sure that it is based on a theory. So it's a priori. It is based on a theory which already exists. So what do you do in a content analysis? You first search a theory, and based on that theory, you do a PIE, personal interview or a focus group, collect data, analyze it, and then confirm that yes, even in India, that theory applies. So that is the whole role of content analysis. Now, vis-a-vis this, opposite of content analysis is a concept called grounded theory. Okay, that's a concept called grounded theory. Now, what is grounded theory? It was given by Glaser and Strauss. Grounded theory is, I am describing something. I am doing a study where I do not have a past theory. Okay, so I am going to conduct interviews, I am going to study existing documents, review of literature, and then I'm going to devise a new theory. Mind you, here when I go and do my personal interviews, when I do my focus group interviews, or I collect audios and videos, I have nothing in mind. So which means I have no pre-structured theory saying attitude affects intention in mind. I am leaving it open. I am letting the people say what they want to say, and on the basis of what they say, I will devise a theory. Okay, so that is grounded theory. Grounded theory is not that easy. It means you have to have a very solid conceptual knowledge also. Because see, it's easy to do a content analysis because there you have a theory, you're just proving it through qualitative data. So you're just taking people's interview and proving that that theory is existent in India. But in a grounded theory, there is no theory backing it. So I think the example that I gave you, what happens after death, the example that I gave you for exploration, what happens after death is a very good example of a grounded theory. So that person went with an open mind because nobody had ever written on what happens after death. He did a research and then made his theory himself. So that is grounded theory. But even for doing grounded theory, you will have to collect data. Data collection will could be similar for grounded theory as was for content. So the same interviews, the same past review of literature, the same focus group, the same audio video can be used in grounded theory, content analysis, ethnography, case study. So these are just types of qualitative research. The data collection that you do within them could be similar. So an interview could be used for all, a focus group could be used for all, past review of literature could be used for all. The only difference is in the approach of making the theory in all these types of theories. And then there is something called phenomenological study. Now, what is phenomenological study is that you are describing an event, activity, or a phenomena, okay? And you're describing it in a qualitative method. Now, I think the best example that I can give you is the year 2020 and the corona episode. So this one phenomena which happened in 2020 is going to be a big basis of qualitative studies, and there are journals which are working specially on or have special issues on corona times and brand image, corona and so and so, 2020 epidemic and the impact on brand. So there are already journals which are working on special issues on that. So what they are wanting to do is they are wanting you to go to the consumer at this time of corona in 2020 and go and ask people that will you purchase my product once the malls are open? So they want you to analyze that, and they want you to analyze that qualitatively. So what you have to do is you have to go places, get videos, talk to people, and find out. I mean, the biggest study which people are wanting in corona times 2020 was that once the corona is over and the malls open and businesses open, will people go to the market? So right now, if you see that, in corona times, in the month of August, when the malls, August 2020, when the malls did open, the footfall was not there. Now, all this is phenomenological study because this is all based on one phenomena. It happened in 2020, it will never happen again. It has never happened in past studies, it will never happen again. So this is more of a phenomenological study because it is one phenomena and it is never going to happen again. So the best example of this is the 2020 corona phase, which could become a phenomenological study, a qualitative study for many of the researchers. Now, this all that I've explained you are all types of qualitative research. nVivo helps in analyzing all the data that you collect from this whole all types of studies. There is a second very crucial thing that nVivo helps you in, or qualitative analysis helps you in, and that is making up a new scale. So many of the people in my workshops ask me that, especially when I do workshops for PhD scholars, they say, "Ma'am, why should I take a construct which has already been studied by someone?" So they say that, "Why should I take attitude and intention when I know that somebody, or not somebody, hundreds of people have studied the relationship between attitude and intention. Hundreds of people have studied the relationship between subjective norm and intention." So many of the people in my workshop say that I don't want to do this, I want to do something new. And they also argue that what is my contribution to research if I'm just picking up a scale given by some author in attitude, some author in intention, and just finding out a correlation between them. So which of course many authors have done. So then I tell them that, listen, if you really feel And you don't have to feel, by the way. You have to, again, support it with some literature. So if you have a new construct which affects intention, say, for example, you say that ethical concern is a construct and it impacts purchase intention. Now, you have seen that in past research, in qualitative research, where, you know, the researchers have gone to samples and they have asked them, okay, when you purchase a product, is the ethical concern crucial for you? So they have done personal interviews, they have brought in data, and they have concluded through qualitative data that ethical concern is crucial. This much of past research you should be having even if you're making a scale. So even if you feel I want to make a new standard scale, or I want to make a new instrument, or I want to make my own questionnaire for a construct called ethical concern, you should be having a paper which says that ethical concern impacts intention. That could be a qualitative paper. Doesn't matter if there is no construct in it. Doesn't matter if there is no standard scale given for that construct called ethical concern. Now, once it has been proven by some XYZ that ethical concern does impact intention, there is no scale of it. There are no items for it. There are no statements for that one construct which is named ethical concern. Now, what do I do? I want to make a major contribution to my research. I want to study the impact of ethical concern on intention quantitatively. Not qualitatively, that somebody has already studied. I want to study it quantitatively. I want to do a correlation between the two. But to do a correlation, I have to have a standard scale of ethical concern. I have a standard scale of purchase intention, but I don't have a standard scale of ethical concern. What do I do? Here, what you have to do is you have to construct your own scale. And you will be the first person to construct a scale. And in research, there is quantitative research, there is qualitative research, but a research paper, and you should see research papers if you intend to do so, there are research papers which have done nothing. They have not done a quantitative, they have not done a qualitative, they have just constructed a scale. So scale construction by itself is a whole paper by itself. And how you do it, how you will go for that ethical concern and construct it, that is what I am going to describe. And I'm going to describe how NVivo is going to help in it. Okay, so just let me describe. So scale development and validation are crucial to many of the works in health, social and behavioral sciences because a construct is a latent variable. Latent variable means you can't measure it in kgs and kilos and meters, etc. So you have to measure them through statements. You have to measure them through Likert scale on the statements. But then if there are no standard scales, there are no standard statements, you will have to construct them. And that is when we need the scale development. So just look at this. Why scale development? Because now let's look at this theory. This is a theory I study very frequently. Many of you, if you have been, and this is a theory being studied in marketing, HR, criminology, sociology, psychology. So it's a multidisciplinary theory, general theory that I picked up. It's called theory of planned behavior given by Askin. Now in this theory, just look at the theory. It says attitude, subjective norm and perceived behavioral control impact intention. Intention further impacts behavior. Now, this is a standard theory, by the way. It has been given by a researcher. There are standard scales. Now, there are five constructs. Attitude is one construct. Subjective norm is another construct. Perceived behavioral control, intention, behavior. These are all constructs. Why we call them constructs is because they cannot be measured in numbers, kgs, kilos, meters. They have to be measured by statements. So I should have a standard author saying there are three statements to measure attitude. I should have a standard scale given by an author who says there are four statements for subjective norm, five statements for PVC, so on and so forth. And I have it. So in my past literature, I have authors who have given me a standard scale for attitude, subjective norm, intention, behavior, PVC. Now, what I have to do is I have to just relate to them, but I'm not satisfied. Why should I do that? N number of researchers have done that. N number of researchers are using a standard scale. I want to make my own standard scale. So I go back and study what are the extensions to this theory, and I found out that one of the extensions to this theory was made again by Aston himself in the year 2000, where he said that there is an extra construct called actual behavioral control, and that impacts behavior. Okay, so there is a new construct which he said actual behavioral control impacts behavior. Now, how did he say that? He said that with a qualitative analysis. So he has already done a qualitative analysis through personal interviews, etc., where he has proven that actual behavioral control leads to actual behavior. So I'm not going to repeat that qualitative analysis. That has been done already. I don't have to repeat it. What do I have to do? I have to construct a scale, a standard scale, or a set of statements or items for the construct called actual behavioral control. And when I was trying to do this, I also wrote to Dr. Askin, and he replied that there is no scale as yet of actual behavioral control. So I'm really trying to make a scale, and how you do it is something which I'll tell you in NVivo and review of literature, how we actually build a scale of actual behavioral control. And it is done, you would be surprised, it is done by personal interviews only. So if you have to construct a statement or a scale of actual behavioral control, you can very well do it with personal interviews. Okay, so let me come to stages of scale development. So step number one is that you have to start generating items. What are items? In a standard scale, you have 3-4 statements in front of which you put a Likert scale, strongly agree to strongly disagree. These statements, mind you, these statements cannot be generated by you yourself. It has to be generated through a process. So it's not that I know the definition of attitude. So, okay, the 3 statements which measure attitude will be so and so, so and so. It is not possible to, make it just like that. If researchers are making it just like that, it's wrong. It's wrong. Rather, it has to be made only and only if you say these are the 3 statements of attitude. It has to be made by studying past literature review and doing a personal interview. I'll show you how. And generally, we take items from a standard scale from authors. So if there is, but there are in psychology, there are constructs, as I said, ethical concern, where there are no items. So for that, you will have to make your own scale. And how do you make a scale? You could make items after a study of review of literature, personal interviews, social media data, data from videos and audios of experts who are speaking about a topic. So now, let me construct a scale for, say, a purchase intention of sustainable products. So now I'm constructing a scale. Now, this is an example of a research paper. You all can go and read it if you want to understand what exactly I'm saying. Now, this was a paper by Strauss and Liendre, and they've actually constructed a scale. Okay, so they have constructed a scale for justification of unethical behavior. So that there was no scale of, justification of unethical behavior. They have constructed one. Now, there are many weird constructs. Now, justification of unethical behavior is not a common construct like attitude, intention, etc. It's different. So if it's different, you will not have a standard scale for it. And you will have to make it yourself. And the process of doing it yourself is something that I'm about to describe. So what do you do? Now, suppose I have to make a scale on ethical consumption. Okay, so what am I doing? I'm making a scale on ethical consumption. I'm trying to list out the factors which affect purchase intention. So there could be 2 things. Either I'm making a scale on ethical consumption. Okay, I'm trying to ask people, what do you understand by ethical consumption? And they say a few lines and I make statements. The second could be, I'm trying to find out all the factors which affect ethical purchase. And I go and ask consumers that what are the factors which affect you when you're doing an ethical purchase or when you're purchasing a sustainable product. Now, how do you make a scale of it? First thing first, I will go and read all the past literature. So I go and read all the past literature, and right in front of you, please take a minute. Please take a minute. Read the literature on the left side and see how I have converted it into items or statement on the right side. Please take a minute and read it. Please take a minute and read it. So if you see the major lines which are there in review of literature, consumer agrees that the companies must engage in socially responsible practices, but they refuse to assume the possible consequences, namely higher prices. So from here I get my first statement, I will buy sustainable products only if they are cheap. Okay, I get my first statement. Also, although consumers say they are willing to pay more to buy ethical products, the majority do not do so because functional attribute is most important to them. So here I bring my second or third statement, which is I will buy sustainable products if they have a similar functional attribute. Now when I say similar functional attribute, it means similar to a normal product. Sustainable product, normal product. So from review, I studied review, and you know, it's not as simple as just taking a paragraph and writing a line. For this one sentence, this one item that I have written, or one statement that I have written, to which in future I'm going to add strongly agree to strongly disagree, I will have to take at least 4 to 5 authors, you know, who say so, and then I can draft this one statement. Okay. Another thing I can do is, once I have done this through review of literature, I will further check it with person interviews. Now, this was only secondary data analysis that I've done to make statements, to make a scale for purchase of sustainable products. The second thing I will do is, I will take personal interviews. I will take personal interviews. I will import data into NVivo. I will do something called an open coding, line-to-line coding or open coding. I will make themes or codes, I will do the word counts, and I will say, okay, according to NVivo, maybe I get some 4 more items than what I already have. So when I do an NVivo analysis of a personal interview, when I go and ask people, have you heard of sustainable consumption? Will you pay more if I give you a sustainable product which is pricey? And then people say, no, I will not give you more, price is very important to me, there are so many products which are less priced in the market, I will not buy. So again, it is supporting which statement? My statement number one. So now what has happened is, my statement number one is fixed. Reason being, review supports it, review of literature supporting it, plus my NVivo analysis done on personal interview is supporting. So, after doing this process continuously, you know, this is a mixed process. So, I'm going to use secondary data, which is my past review, which is research papers, to get statements. I am going to do a personal interview. I might also take videos of experts who have spoken about sustainable consumption and what are the factors which affect people when they buy sustainable consumption. I could take those videos also. I could take a few audio interviews of the fathers of sustainable consumption, for example, Dr. Russell Belk, Dr. Sheeran, okay, Dr. Timothy. So these are all authors who have worked on sustainable consumption. If I get their research papers, I might take them and analyze in NVivo. I can take their audios and analyze in NVivo, and of course my own personal interviews which I have got from my samples, Indian samples, I can analyze, and overall analysis of that will give me these statements. So if you, if referring to this paper example that I have given you, Estouse and Legendre, this whole process is what they did, and they finally got these many items or sentences for a construct called economic rationality. Okay, so what must they have done? You know, first they must have studied economic rationality through review of literature like we did, listed out some items. Then they must have collected personal interviews asking people, what do you understand by economic rationality? Okay, further they must have written some statements. They could be overlapping or they could be an add-on of these four. They could be overlapping, for example, in review as well as in personal interview as well as in a audio taken by an expert. Three people are saying the same thing, price. Okay, and when we do this manually, it becomes very difficult, but I'll show you how we do it in NVivo. Because when we do it in NVivo, what happens is NVivo actually tells me that in my whole data, which includes 10 personal interviews, 3 audios, 2 videos, 5 research papers, NVivo will actually tell me where all in these 20 sets of data, including audio, video, review of literature, PI, where in these 20 set of data price or cheap price is coming. So if I know that all of my 20 data, expert audios, personal interviews from sample, review of literature of past authors, if all of them have the word cheap, and it says, okay, this construct cheap is coming from 3. When we do modeling, we will see comes from 3, which means definitely this is one of the statements. This is one of the items for my construct called sustainable consumption. Okay, so this is the whole process we are about to do. And as I said, we could do this analysis, qualitative analysis, for either making up a theory. Okay, so if I want to find out what are the factors which affect the sustainable consumption about Indians, why do I want to find out? There are n number of studies which have been done in UK, Europe, etc., which do show what are the major factors that affect sustainable consumption. Why do I want to do it? I want to do it. I have to have a rationale to do it. So if you're doing an exploratory study, you have to have a rationale, reason for doing it. I want to do it because in Diwali, when green crackers came into place and everybody knew that, say, India had a lot of pollution or Delhi had a lot of pollution and green crackers could have helped, people still did not purchase it. So the Indian behavior towards sustainable consumption or ethical consumption or socially responsible consumption is very different from the other countries. So I want to do a qualitative research of only and only Indians. Only and only Indians, because nobody has done it. And the qualitative analysis from Indians of why they did not purchase green crackers in Diwali will be very, very different from all the past research that has been done abroad. Okay, so that is one thing. I might be able to create a new theory altogether. So there might be things like, for example, availability, emotional quotient of children. You know, my children said, no, I want crackers today, that's it. So I didn't have time to go for a green cracker. Maybe somebody says that. So emotional quotient, availability of the crackers, price of the crackers, time constraints, okay, family pressure. So I might get these 5 variables from personal interview, and these 5 variables which I've got for Indians for ethical consumption will not be there anywhere else in the world. This is my contribution. But to get these 5 variables, I will have to interview somewhere around 30 people and then 30 people and then come to coding to these 5 items. Okay, also these 5 factors could become 5 items or 5 statements of a scale called sustainable consumption among Indians, which is a scale which is not present anywhere. It is not present anywhere. I might be the first one to do it. So this whole process that I'm telling you, and even after that, once you get these statements, then we go to a quantitative process called EFA, exploratory factor analysis, and then but that is after data collection. So first you make the scale and then you show the scale for content validity to an expert, where the expert tells you that the scale is good or not. Okay, and that is when you, in front of each of these statements, you put strongly agree to strongly disagree, and then you go for a quantitative analysis. Okay, Further, when you have collected data from somewhere around at least 500 people on this scale, you do something called an EFA, exploratory factor analysis, which is out of the scope of this workshop. But even after making these statements through qualitative research, you will further have to go and do an EFA. You will, after making these statements through an analysis of NVivo and everything, you will further have to go and do a content validity by asking experts that, sir, these are the statements which came out through NVivo analysis of personal interviews, focus group, audios, videos, review of literature papers. Now, please let me know if these statements are okay or not. So the expert will say, okay, Jaspreet, I think the last statement should be chucked out. You will chuck it out. You will chuck it out. Because content validity from an expert is very, very crucial. So out of the 10, you might check out the 10th one and you're left with 9 items. Now, these 9 items, you will put a scale strongly agree to strongly disagree. Collect data of 500 people. Go for an EFA. When you do an EFA, you might see that these statements are again clubbed into 2-3 factors. So 9 statements may get clubbed into 3 factors. Or in an EFA, due to problems, 2 statements have to be removed. So now you're left with 7 statements. So this is your standard scale. This is your standard scale. These 7 statements are your standard scale. And you can write a paper saying that this is the standard scale that I developed for a construct called sustainable consumption, which was never developed ever in the past literature. So this is the whole process. I hope it's clear. I will now take you to NVivo. So I hope, you know, first thing first, the type of qualitative analysis is clear, and what NVivo is about to do is clear. So if it is clear, let us go now to NVivo. Okay, here I am. It takes a little bit of time to open. Now, this is what your NVivo screen looks like. All of you who have downloaded the trial version, let me tell you that you will get an option. The moment you start the software, you will get an option which will say work on an existing project or open a new project. Okay, so you go to open a new project. Okay, I repeat, when you guys download, I will be repeating each process twice so that all of you can follow it. And any questions, please put it up in the group. Okay, any questions for today, please put it up in the group. I will be answering each and every question daily. Okay, so this is an NVivo software. When you open it first, it will say open an existing file, or it will say work on a new project. You go to new project and a page will open. Forget these codings, etc. Or do you want me to work on a new page? I'll work on a new page. So let me go to a new page. NVivo is a heavy software and might just be. So this is your project, okay? Okay, you get this sort of a page where it says open existing project, or it says open a new project. So just for a demo sake, I'm opening up a new project. Okay, I'll not work on an old project. I'll work on a new project. Do you want to save? Okay, yes, I want to. So I'll explain all this on a new project. Okay, one more thing. Till the time these little, you know, it takes analysis, does take a little bit of time in NVivo. So in case you people want to work on a free software, not NVivo, but a free software, you could download something called QDA Miner. Okay, you can, okay, now it is opening a new software. It's asking for a project title. So I say demo NVivo class. You could also describe it, but here I'm not describing it because I want it to open. So, and we say create project. Okay, so I hope the steps are clear and it will create a new page altogether. I will start with how we import data and all that. So QDA Miner is a free software. You can download it, but it only does basic coding. So if you want to do a coding of review of literature, or you want to do a coding of personal interviews, you can do it over there. But for the things which NVivo does, like sentiment analysis or other functions which NVivo does, those advanced functions are not there in QDA Miner because it being a free software. So if you have a free software, okay, so this is it, and it says, I think this page you also must have seen. I have to say new project. Okay, so QDA Miner you can do for coding. If you have a personal interview, you just want to code it. QDA Miner is a free software. Of course, it cannot do a sentiment analysis. It cannot do an analysis of Facebook, Twitter, etc., which I'll tell you. I have not checked audio or video analysis, but I would request all of you to please download QDA Miner also, which is free of cost, and just see what all features it has. So let's just check what all features it has. I know it has coding. I have done coding on it, and it's free of cost. So at least your coding of data can be done in that. Very advanced sentiment analysis, etc., might not be done. So that, of course. Just taking a little bit of time to open. Okay. Here comes the new project. Now, this is like a new page altogether. Okay, if it says start tool, just skip tool because it wants to take you to all the features of NVivo. Now, this is what your NVivo looks like. Those of you who have NVivo 12, NVivo 11, there might just be some very minor changes. Most of the features of 11 and 12 are same. So, nothing to worry. Now, let me start the first thing, which is importing files, because this is a clean page and nothing has happened here. So, let me go to... I'm going to import file. Okay, I press import. I will tell you what is mCapture. Okay, mCapture is a feature where you, and please do download this mCapture. Okay, it has to be downloaded. It has to be visible on Google Chrome. Okay, so mCapture you will have to download. It will be visible on Google Chrome. So whenever you open a Facebook or you open a Twitter, etc., you will see this icon of NVivo on the right side. So it will be easy to import data, all the data from Facebook, all the data from Twitter in a single click. So that powerful mCapture it. So when you mCapture it from the internet, it will come to your desktop, and from there we will import it to the... I will explain mCapture in the next session. So here I am, import, and I go to files. I'm going pretty slow because I'm assuming there are people who are working for the first time. And I say, okay, there are three interviews I'm taking. So there is Garima, 18 years interview, Mrs. Asha, Mrs. Pathak, and let me also take Mrs. Satya. So I say four interviews you import, and he says, should I import? I say, yes, you import. Okay, so it will take a little time to import the four files that I have selected. By the way, all these four files are personal interviews, and the first thing I'm about to do with you is coding. Okay, so the first thing that we are starting in NVivo, you can see my files are there. They are showing on the screen, all the four files. I went to import, I went to files, I took the four files, and I put it into my project. Okay, this is my project. The project name is Demo NVivo, and I have imported all the files into this. These are my four personal interviews, which I want to analyze, and I say want to make a scale, suppose, or I want to just make up a theory. Right? So whether I'm doing a grounded theory where I don't have a theory in the beginning, and from these four people's data I will build a theory, or I'm doing something like a content analysis where I have a theory, I will confirm that theory from these four data, whatever the process of qualitative analysis be. My input over here is personal interview. Okay, so the same can be done for projective techniques. Suppose I had asked Garima ma'am, Garima, Asha, Pathak, etc., all these interviewees. Suppose I asked, okay, when you think of a brand called Bingo, what do you think? And they give me long transcripts of 20 minutes. I think this. So even that can be put into four inputs. So even for projective techniques, you have the same input. So input is same. What you have to do with this grounded or case study or ethnography, that is different. Okay, so now let me come to, I will press Garima 18 years. Okay, I will double click Garima 18 years. And you will see that on the right side, there will be a window which will open, which will show me the whole script in Word document. Okay, so if you see, this is the whole script of Garima. These are the questions I asked in my personal interview, and these are the answers Garima gave for it. Okay, now the same can happen with all other files. So if I say double click on Asha, and all of you please do this and see, I'm repeating twice. I'm going very slow. So all of you please do it and see. There is no use rushing and learning nothing. So now this is Asha's interview. These are the questions. The questions are same because for all these four people, I had asked the same questions. And by the way, let me also tell you, how do you decide what questions to ask? I actually read past literature to judge the questions I could ask. Also, I had taken an expert interview of two people from IIM who mentored me and who said, okay, these questions are okay. So I did show my personal interview transcript also, personal interview questions also to experts before asking these questions. So I told them my objective, I showed them. So my content validity is perfect. So this is for Asha. Similarly, you press on Pathak. So any place you will press, and on the right side it will show you all the scripts. Now this is the script of Pathak. You will see that the questions are similar, and what we have to analyze is, we have to analyze each and every question. Now this is how you import data. This is how you can see your files on the right side. Now in front of these names, you see something called codes and references. This is what we are about to do. Now, what is codes or what is coding? Code is nothing but it is a theme given to a transcript. Now, these are called transcripts, by the way. Okay, so for me, whether it's a personal interview, if you're not doing with a personal interview, you're doing with secondary data. So these four files will become four research papers. Okay, so the same thing has to be done with them as is to be done with the personal interview. Now, what is coding? Coding is a method of giving a theme to this whole research. So this whole research of four people, I will be dividing into themes. And those themes will actually become either my items or they will become my factors affecting a particular construct. So I have to give themes. This, by the way, this was also done manually when I was doing my PhD in way back in 2010. I had done all this manually. Okay, but the shock will be that this coding that we are about to start is a line to line coding. Okay, so for all those people who thought that now I have put my data into NVivo, all I have to press is an auto code and my coding will be done and my work is done, you are here for a big shock. You're here for a big shock. Coding is a line-to-line process to be done for all transcripts, not only one, for every transcript. And it's a very, very lengthy process. Okay. We used to do it manually. How we used to do it, like I'll give you a very simple example. When we used to study, suppose we were studying from the NCRT social studies, we used to use a highlighter and say, okay, this is an important point. Remember, that is all you have to do in coding in NVivo. That is exactly what you have to do in coding in NVivo. Okay, so now let's start. I go to codes. Okay, you have on the left side coding and you have codes. Okay, and this is all text. At every point in NVivo, you will get what are. So codes are themes that you identify in your data. It is just explaining what it is. Now, here what you do is, just a second. You go to code and just click a right click. On the left side, you see this bar, okay, the menu bar, and it says coding, go to codes and have a right click. Just do a right click and go to new code. Okay, I repeat, on the left side, you have this toolbar. In that, you have something called coding. In coding, you go to code, do a right click, and there opens a window. And it says, what is the name of your code? Okay, so I say the name of my code is, let me say the name is money. I'm just taking a code because I've read the transcript, so it's easy for me to make a code. I'm just showing you how to make a code. Now, if you see over here, there is a code named money. Okay. Now, if there is any statement, just hear this out. There is another way of doing this also. I'll tell you both the ways. Just hear this out. You can either first make a code and then put sentences into it, or you can do the other way around. You can go to sentences and make codes as per sentences. So I'm telling you both the ways. I'm telling you the first way first. I have read the transcripts and I feel that money would be a crucial factor. Now, why do I say that? Remember, I told you content analysis. In content analysis, we have a predefined theory. Okay. So when I have read articles about sustainable consumption before collecting this data, theory said that money or price is a very, very crucial factor while purchasing a sustainable product. I showed you review articles in the PPT. Okay, so there were review articles in the PPT also where past authors have said money is important. So that is why, because I had a pre, I'm not doing a grounded theory, I'm doing a content analysis. I have this predefined notion. There is a theory ready in my mind. The theory is ready, it's been given by authors. And one of the points of that theory was money. Okay, so let me see in my interviews, suppose this is interview number one. Now what I do is I can see money, I can see code money. Now I go back on the left side in data and I go back to my files. I go to data and I go back to my files and I say, okay, show me the data of Garima. I say, okay, show me the interview of Garima. And on the right side, you have a script of Garima. Okay. Now, I will pick up the sentences from here which are talking about money. Okay. Now, just read it out. Thank you for the opportunity you gave me to talk about my family. I am in 12th standard. My family has got 6 members, housewife, so-and-so. No money hasn't come. Okay. Anything about, buying, purchase is there, but that is not money. Anything about money. Reuse, I'm very conscious. Okay. Anything about money? No, there is, you have to read it word by word, and there says, no, there is nothing about. Okay, yeah, here you have a line. Just read, value for money is very important for my family. Whenever I buy something expensive, we think many times. Now you will highlight this one sentence which is talking about money. Say a right click. Okay, click on right click. Go on code selection. Okay, it will show you in codes, it will show money. Click on money and say code selection to money. Okay, I am repeating the process. I had a pre-built theory in my mind. I am doing content analysis over here. I have a pre-built theory in my mind. I know that in sustainable consumption, money could be a very crucial factor. It is said by many authors. So I want to find out in the whole text, has the Indian consumer mentioned money anywhere? Okay, money, cost, cheap, price, anywhere. I go through the transcript. I found out that value for money is an important thing. I highlight that text. I go to right click. I say code selection. In the code, there was only one code I have defined for the software, which was money. And I click on money and I say code selection to money. Okay. Now, what do you see in front of Garima? Let's see what it shows in front of Garima. In front of Garima, it shows code 1, reference 1, which means in the file called Garima, you have one code. What is that? Money, of course. And you have one reference. What does reference mean? In this one code money, you could put more than one reference. Reference are all the sentences in which money has come. Now, let me see in money, is there a second reference? Is there a second sentence? So here it comes. Majorly, it is to save money that I prefer anti-consumption. What do I have to do? I have to send this sentence also into money. So I say right click, code selection. It will show me money because I've given it a money name already. Code selection to money. Now what do you see in Garima's file? Code is only one money. Okay, we are still working only on one code. And there are two references. So in Garima, for money, there are two references. Okay, we will go further. And read line by line and search such references and put it into this code called money. Okay, now I have read theory, so I'm going back to code. And I say there is one more code. People could believe in anti-consumption, or people could believe in preserving their old clothes, etc., or not wasting their old stuff, or sustainability, because they are emotionally attached to it. Okay? This I've read in past. The theory says what impacts purchase intention of sustainable product. So one thing is that the amount of money they have to pay. Second thing is the emotionality they have to old product. So if they have a high emotionality, they will not buy new products. Okay, so they will become sustainable. This is all what I'm not saying this. This is something theory has said. So my second code, again I go to codes, I right click, I say new code, and now my code is emotions. And I say, okay. If you want to write a description, you can write, but otherwise you can just say emotions and this. Now in the codes, you see two codes. One is money. It was found for one file. Which was that file? Garima's file. There were two references. What do you mean? There were two sentences where Garima used the word money. Then you go to emotions. Now let me go back to files, left side, data. And in files, and I say, okay, open Garima. Garima is still open. Garima is presently open. And I say, okay, let me read the script and see if she is ever emotional about a product. So I read this whole script. Okay, I go line by line. This is also called open coding. Okay, so I go line by line. And I say, okay, where is Garima's emotion? Is she emotional at all? Is there anything to do with emotions? In fact, there is a question which I asked about emotions. So I will definitely get it. And all my questions also were based on past theory. So because past theory said that people are emotional, so I put it as a question just to check if Indians are emotional or not. Now here it is. Is there any social or emotional aspect of reducing consumption? And she says, yes, it is an emotional aspect in reducing consumption. and this has emotional value. Now, what do you do? Select, right click, code selection. It will give you two options now, money and emotion. Where should I put it? Should I put it in money or emotion? I should put it in emotion. I click emotion and it says code selection to emotion. Okay. Now, I will not do this for further coding. I hope the point is understood. Emotions and money were two of the factors which affect ethical consumption. Research told me that. So I judge these. There could be another 10 factors. You could do this on 10 factors. But what I want to do now is, I want to code all my transcripts for these two codes. So I did Garima's coding. There were two codes and three references. Now I want to do it for Miss Asha also. Okay. So I'll just do it and show it to you. So wherever there is money, okay, I have to read through, and wherever there is money, okay, here it is. Money is not much in our hand, so we cannot afford to spend on commuting, so and so. Okay, right click, code selection, money. I'm doing this for a purpose, okay. And I'll just code one more of emotion because I'm doing this for a purpose. I need to show you something. That is why I'm doing it. Okay. And I want one sentence on emotion. Here it is. We have social as well as emotional aspect. For example, knitting from old sweaters and all that. Okay. So I click this, right click, code selection, and I say emotions. Okay. Code selection motions. Now you see, Mrs. Asha, two codes, two references. I would like to do it lastly for Mrs. Pathak because I want to show you something. Okay, so anything that Mrs. Pathak says about money, grocery items, clothing twice, she purchased four times a day. Actually, okay, yes, I'm fond of good clothes which give value for money. Okay, right click, code selection, put it into money and say code selection to money. Okay, further, there is a question I have asked on emotions. So I'll be quick. Importance is, here it is. So money is, again, I've got another code on money. Money is not available with us. So code selection. Money, I got two codes, I got two references for money. That time this thing is like emotional attachment. So we reuse things. So she says that there is an emotional attachment because of which she reused code selection, and I go to emotions. Okay, here you go. And let me do a mini. You have to do this for the whole document. And all of those who thought that we just input data and it automatically codes, you're all mistaken. So now I have three documents. Okay, so there's Garima, 18 years, interview Mrs. Asha, interview Mrs. Pathak. Okay, so these are the codes. Now if I go to codes, now this is what it shows file wise. So file wise it is showing how many codes are there in each file. So Garima has two codes, money, emotions, three references. Asha ma'am had two codes and two references. Pathak has two codes, two references. Now let me go to codes again. Okay, so in coding left side, I go to codes. And here you see, it also shows you the other way around. So it shows you in money, how many files have that code. So in the code money is present in three files and in five references. Similarly, it also shows that emotion code is present in which file and in how many references. So the emotion code is present in three files and three references. Okay, so this is how you do coding. So this is one part of this. Now we come to another part. So this is the coding part. Okay, I hope you've understood. In case you're doing a grounded theory, you do the other way around. Okay, in case you do a grounded theory, you do another way around. For example, when I'm doing a grounded theory, how do I do it? How important is value for money in the act of reuse and recycling of domestic commodities in India? I and my family, one daughter, two daughter-in-laws, even my grandparents, so I will pick this up. Okay, till granddaughters and right side, and I will say code selection. Okay, code selection, and there's an option on the right side which says create new. I don't want to code it into money or emotions. I want to code this into something called family size. Okay, I want to code it into, I'm doing grounded theory. I want a new variable. Okay, so I will say create new, and it will say top level. Okay, and the new code I will say name it family size. Okay, name it family size, and it will create a new code which is family size. As you can see, only one sentence which I have highlighted has been coded into family size. Similarly, I might go forward, and you know, when you're doing a grounded theory, right now my research is grounded theory based. I am doing this and I'm asking old women in India. So these are my actual transcripts where I've collected data, and I'm asking the Indian woman that in olden times when you were anti-consuming and you were sustainable and there were huge families and little money was being spent, what all things were you not buying, basically? And if you were not buying, why were you not buying it? Was the money a problem? Was the family size too big? Was there a wedding which you had to plan for? Was there an emotional aspect? Or was the society like this? Or did your mothers teach you? What was there in an Indian old woman because of which she was very conscious while consuming, and there was a lot of reuse, and there was a lot of making things at home? Okay, so I'm writing a qualitative paper on that, and these are my actual transcripts, and I'm going by grounded theory. I don't want to take a theory. So I'm going by grounded theory, where I will, you know, code this way, emotions, family size. Further on, I found a quote which was said, a marriage of children. Many people said that marriage of children was something that we were preparing for, so we believed in sustainability. So I am studying all the factors of Generation X, okay, all the baby boomers, that is our parents, and reasons of why they were more sustainable than us. So my research is on factors affecting sustainability in the baby boomers generations in the Indian elders. So that is what my study is. I've done a qualitative analysis and I found out, okay, money was a factor. Emotions was a factor. Family size was a factor. So this is all the coding. And from this, I will make up a theory. Of course, I will support it with past data also. So I have two things over here. I found out three codes or three themes: money, family size, emotions. But at the same time, these three things are also supported by past research. They are also, so there's a dual thing I'm doing. I'm supporting it with personal interview, plus I'm supporting it with past research. So now you have these codes, okay? And now we will go to, coding is finished. Now we will go to explore. Let's explore that in these files. Let me come to the file view, okay? I have four files. And I go to explore. Now let me see what all can I explore automatically. Now this is a line-to-line coding, and you'll have to do it. It's also called open coding or a line-to-line coding, and you will have to do it. Okay. So all of you who thought that Anvi was just putting automatically, it's not that. You'll have to do a line-to-line coding and make your codes and then come out with an item or come out with a theory. Now let's go to explore. Okay. And let's go to word frequency. Okay, I go to explore and I go to word frequency. Okay, now it will ask me which file do you want to analyze, and I say, okay, analyze Garima's file. Okay, I have clicked on Garima and I say, okay, do a word frequency. What do I want to find a word on? I'm not finding out a word. What I'm trying to see is that when Garima was describing her sustainable consumption in a script of 1800 words, what were the most important factors which came out in her transcript? For that, I do a word frequency test. How do I do it? I just go to word frequency, okay? And I will go and just say on the right side, run query. But before that, before that, what I will do is, if it tells me select items, you see select items, so I will say, okay, do this only for, as of now, I want only for Garima, and I say okay. Okay, so it will give me an option of select items. You can see file and external, select item, select folder. So select items, I'm only selected Garima right now. I could select all four also, but right now I've selected only Garima. Now in grouping, on the right side in grouping, you can move this cursor left or right, below also. And I say, either you say exact match. When I say exact match means, if there is a word called talk and there's a word called talking, it will group them into two different words. But I don't want that. I want talk, talking, talkative, all those words to come together. So it is like saying, here my code is price. Okay, so I want price, money, value for money, all similar words to be, even synonyms to be mixed up, mixed up and grouped into one category. So I go to the third option, which is with synonyms. Okay, so now talk, speak, all words related to that will come. So for in my case, because I want the code money. Okay, so money, price, value, all these synonyms will come together and be clubbed into one. Okay, so I'll get a basic theme out of this. And I do this and I say, okay, minimum length, it says 3 words. Okay, when you say 3 words, it might also list words like A-R-E-R, U, which might not be important. Okay, so let's first do a very basic run query. So I do a run query. Okay. And it'll take a few seconds. Okay, here we have it. So it has the words. Listen, the maximum used words that is 22 times used. 22 times used was recycle, recycled, reuse, reuse. Okay. I give it more to my questions because I put questions like that. Look at the second category. Class, family. Okay. So 15 words in this whole script talk about family and class. Now, what do you conclude from this? You conclude that family is a very important factor when people are going for sustainable consumption. This is what I conclude. And based on this, you could also do coding. So you could go reverse. You could first find out the words that people speak. For example, buying, purchasing, consumption, old, father, generation, mother, again family. So what is this? This is again family. So family comes twice, once 15, once 11. So just imagine the impact of family. Okay. There is another count of 7 which says generation. Okay. Although this is a very, very subjective, evaluation. But I see from this word count that family and, class, family, generation, father, mother, all these words are coming again and again. So in sustainable consumption, family is definitely one factor. Okay. How you find it out? You find it out through a word count. Now, this is a summary of a word count. On the right side, you have summary and then you have something called a word cloud. Okay. You have something called a word cloud. Okay. And this is what is a word cloud. It'll again take a second or so, and it will give you a cloud and it will show you the most prominent words in huge cloud form of a thing. So these sometimes I see in research papers the word cloud has been given to prove the point that this factor is crucial for this particular qualitative study. Yeah, so this is your family. If you see in the word count also, family, mother, purchase, old, consumption, okay, clothes has come, okay, domestic, commodities, okay, so people are speaking a lot about family, people are speaking a lot about their commodity purchase, These are the two major factors which have come out of word cloud. When I talk of Garima, I have still only analyzed Garima. If you want to do this analysis for all four, you will have to, okay, it also shows, let me complete this. So you have a summary, you have a word cloud, you have a tree map. Okay, you have a tree map. Okay, so what does the tree map shows? It shows children within the tree. So people are talking about reuse. When they are talking about reuse, they are talking about consumption and old products. When they are talking about consumption, they are talking about commodities. Okay, when they are talking about old products, they are talking further. So these are all branched trees. Okay, also you can do something called a cluster analysis. But I think we'll stop at tree map, and tree map shows you where. So when look at family, so when it says family, it says mother. Okay, and also what you can do is, I'm going back to summary. You know, there are words you could probably you could make this three word into at least five words. If you make it five words and run query, things will change. Okay, so things might change. So these small little words like, oh, so see, you have a better analysis now. 133 items, it says. Okay, now I have done this only for one file. You could do it for four files. Okay, and this is one way of analyzing themes. Okay, and once you analyze themes from here repetitively, then you can say, okay, my code will be family, my code will be commodity purchase, okay, my code will be money. So depending on that, right? So this is an analysis. I have reduced the minimum length from 3 to 5 so that words like are and for can be removed. So here I get a better analysis, right? So this is word count. Now I go to my next one, which is called text search. Okay. Despite the fact that I was very, very satisfied that family was a concern, consumption was a concern, that is okay. What I want to see is money a concern. So I want to write money in text search. I went to explore, I went to text search, and here I said, okay, please check in Garima's text if there is something called money. And why only in Garima's? I select items and I select all four items. I say in Garima, Asha, Pathak, Satya. I want all interviews to be seen, all four interviews to be seen, and see if there is something called money in all four interviews. I also say, please check all the synonyms. So if it's money or cash or liquid cash or price, it should be showing. And after doing this, after putting money and writing synonyms and selecting all four files, I do a run query. Okay, I do a run query and it will show me all the files. So you can see that Garima has 3 references of money, Asha has 14 references, Pathak has 20 references, and Satya has 16 references. Okay, if this is the summary of references, if you go on the second, on the right side, you can see this toolbar. If you go to reference, okay, if you go to reference. Okay, so here are all the references. So here are all the sentences where money has been used. So if you want to see in which context the money was used, even that will be shown to you by NVivo. How important is money in the act of reuse? Value for money. Okay, save money. Money is not much with our family. Save money. Lot of money. Shortage of money. Save money. Money constraints. Save money, spent money, waste money. So if you see all these, you know, phrases together, what are they saying? What do you conclude from these 4 Indians or 40 Indians that you have interviewed? You conclude that Indians are very conscious about not wasting money. Okay, they are conservative about money. And that could be one very, very crucial factor in affecting sustainability. So now what have I done? I have judged these transcripts from 2-3 angles. Okay, so one angle was that I did a word count. Money did not reflect over there, but I feel it should, it must be reflecting. I've taken those interviews, it should. So I put money and text. So now I have 3 codes. I have family, I have buying commodities, and I have money. Similarly, If there are other things I want to test, like for example, when I was coding, I was wanting to test emotions. Remember, I wanted to test emotions. So let me test emotions, and I say emotions and run query, and let me see how many people said what. Can I, is it a factor? So now this is references. Let me go to summary. Okay, emotion came 3 times in Garima's text, 5 times in Asha's, 3 times in Pathak. So that's very, very minimalistic. So I think I could probably make it a mini theme, and then maybe I could club it into another theme. So what you do in a qualitative research is that you put transcripts, do a one-to-one coding or open coding, list down the word counts, do a text search, and finally, you come down to some themes. Okay, so look at in this whole process, we have themes like money, family, generations, commodity buying, emotions. I've come to 5 themes. Now, I have done this in just, 15-20 minutes. When you do this whole process, you'll come down to some 30-40 themes. Some people also come down to 100 themes. After coming down to some 30-40 themes, what do you have to do? These are very big. You can't make a theory out of 30-40 themes. That would be a huge theory. You basically need some 4-5 factors. So then out of these 30 themes, you start clubbing. So I would club family and generation into one and make it one theme called family. Okay? So you club these mini themes and make factors, and that is how you get your 5 major factors which are affecting sustainable consumption in old women in India. Okay, so that is the whole process. NVivo, of course, is one thing. But what I wanted to tell you, and it's very rare. I mean, generally, workshops are either on how NVivo works or on either on what qualitative analysis is. The mixture of two is important. Otherwise, NVivo would be of no use at all. So this is about coding. I can further explore. I will go further and explore maps. Okay. So when I go to explore maps, it will ask me, what sort of a map do you want to see? So I say I want to see, suppose, a project map. Okay. And it will say, please name your project map. So I say I am naming it as demo project. Okay. It will ask a description. If you want to write, please write it, or else you can leave it. And okay, here it is. It has created a space for demo map. Now, what is this map? Okay, in the map, what I will do is I will select all the codes and I will drag them to this right hand side, and it will show me all the related areas. I'll tell you how. So, what I do is I will click on money and just a sec, let me click on money and I will drag it here. So it will make a construct called money. Okay, these are, what are they? They are nothing but my constructs. So I just want to see what is the relationship between these constructs. Now I click on family size and I drag it. So there's another construct it will make, a diagram or a map it will make called family size. And then I go to emotions and I drag emotions. So these are my 3 constructs. Now I will click on say money. Okay. And I will go to associated items. Okay. I have clicked on money and I go to associated items, and it says there are 3 files which have a coding money. Okay. It says there are 3 files. So the same thing which was being over here shown. Associated items for each and every construct. For family size, if I go, it will show me that it is there in 3. So for every construct, it will show me the associated items. Okay. Right, now what I do is I say, show me the relationship in different variations. Okay, so these are the variations which you see on the left side. Okay, this is how it can show a relationship, right? And further, if I click on, just a second. Okay, let me. These are the four types of diagrams that it can make with these four relationships. Okay. Okay, so in the map now you can see that there are three constructs. Now what I want is that these are my three codings. Now I go to files, okay, and you see these three things separately. Now these are my three codes. Now I want to see that where do these fall when I, you know, pull out files. So I want to see that how many of my files have common codes of emotion or money in them. So what I do is I select these four files, okay, and like I had dragged the codes into the diagram, now I will drag the files into the diagram. So I have dragged Garima, I'm dragging Asha, I'm dragging Pathak now. Okay, now I'll just explain what I'm doing and what will it show. And I am dragging Satya. Okay. Now, just see. Now, let me reorganize them a little because, you know, otherwise it will become. Okay. Now, just let me make it a little better. Okay, I think now you can see. Okay, so now you see that there are these three codes and it shows that in Garima's file, there were two codes which were shown. So emotions was there and code of money was there. Okay, also in Asha's file, you see the code of emotion and you see the arrow of money also. Okay. Plus, in Pathak's file, you see emotion and you see money. So, basically, what are you seeing? You are seeing that in all three interviewees, these three interviewees could become 20 interviews also. This whole chart could be made for 20 interviews also. All these three interviewees, which further will be 20 interviewees, are talking about emotion, are talking about money. So when all three are talking about emotions, all three are talking about money, which means this is definitely one of my codes. But just look at the family size. There is only and only one person, Pathak, talking about family size. Now, this diagram can help me in grouping up codes. So when I have a code, when I do coding, it's not as simple as getting three codes or three circles. I might get some 20 codes. Now, when I put all my files into this code, it will show me that suppose out of those 20, there are some five codes which are there in every file. So what is this showing? That every interviewer is speaking about that particular code, say emotion and money. So now I can say that if there are five codes about which all 20 interviewees are speaking, this definitely is a part of my model. Okay, so now if I have to make a mini model on what are the factors which affected purchase intention, sustainable purchase intention of the old women in India, I am dead sure that emotion and money was definitely something that did affect the sustainable consumption. At the same time, family size, out of all the 20 that I collected, family size has been named only by one interviewee, Pathak, so I can drop it. I can drop this code. So the selection of the themes and dropping themes for my conceptual model is something I can do through a project map. Okay. At any time, if I want to see the items associated with it, it will show me. So if I select any item, suppose emotions, it will show me the items associated with it. Okay, so every time you click it, every time, so if I clicked, just a second. Okay, the moment I click money, it will show all the references for money also within that diagram. Okay, so that is about exploring maps. In maps, I have just done a project map. Now let me do a concept map. Now let me say I am making a concept map. Now what is a concept map? It's a theoretical map. If you remember, I was doing grounded theory. I was doing it with a very open mind. I have found certain themes. Now I want to make a conceptual map. This is actually my findings, which I will write in my paper. So I say this is a concept of sustainable consumption. This I am making a sustainable consumption for Indian old women. Okay, now this is my conceptual map and I say okay. I say okay. Now see, it has given you an open space to make a map. Okay, now what do you do? First thing first, you go to codes and just simply drag your codes into the map like you did in the previous map also. Just drag. See, these codes are nothing but your themes. So if I have to make a conceptual map, I will have to drag them into my model. This is actually model making. Sorry. I go to explore, I go to maps, I go to conceptual map, and I say sustainability map. I say an okay. It opens a map for me. I go to code. In code, I select money. I drag it in. It makes a circle for money. I say family. I drag it in. It makes a circle for family. And I say I take emotions and I drag it into emotions. Okay. So now what we will do is we will try and relate this to each other. So now I will try and make up a relation of this. Now what I do is that there are three variables and I feel that conceptually they are connected. Okay, so I say I go to this connector. Okay, I go to connector and I say that I feel, and it's not feel, it's something which has been told to me in the task script. So when that lady was narrating her family size, she said that my family size affects money. Okay, so you make an arrow towards this. This is a conceptual thing which I found out from my research, where the lady said I had a very big family and so the money was less. Okay, or I had a very big family. Now, these are all things which, you know, the software will not do for you. The software will not do this for you. You will have to do this yourself by conceptual thinking. Thus the name conceptual map. And this is your final this thing. So you've done the coding. Now what you're doing is you're trying to link concepts on the basis of transcripts. And when you represent these concepts in a qualitative paper, you will actually have to write down that as per so-and-so, she said that because she had a family size of 30, the money was limited. Then X said that I had a huge family and thus could not waste money. So you'll have to give, you just can't put an arrow and say, okay, family size was related to money. When you give this diagram below this, you'll have to give examples of transcripts. And I'll send you research papers where this has been given. So if somebody says this is a concept I've developed, this affects this, they always give transcript examples to support that. Okay, and further, if I say family size was related to money, and suppose I'm just making a supposition that emotions was related to family size, or say emotions was related to money. So I could make such, you know, relationships, okay? I could make such relationships. Right now I have only 3 codes. When I have 20 codes, I can make a lot of crisscross relationships. This is like developing a conceptual model, something which you also do in quantitative research. There's something called an independent variable and there's something called a dependent variable. Okay, so people are emotional, big families, lesser money. So that is how I've connected these dots. Now, further, you could also add some factors which generally we don't add in a conceptual map. For example, let me add a triangle over here. Let me add a triangle over here. And just a second. Let me call. I just want to mark something. See, when I say there was a larger family size and it affected money, I want to also say how it affected money. So I will bring here a triangle and, you know, I will sort of, you know, write in it, edit label on right click. If you go to the triangle, you can write out, you can say size, you can say pressure. Okay, so I say pressure. Now, what am I saying? I'm saying that when the family size was big, money was lesser. Why? Because there was a pressure of sustaining that huge family size on limited resources. Okay, so if I say that the family size was huge and people were emotional, okay, so we can say that when the family size was larger, even if somebody had given me one of the gifts, I was preserving it. I was emotional about it. So because the family size was larger, the number of gifts that were preserved was also more. So the emotional gifts which were preserved were more because my family size was bigger. So this is a very small example of how you can build up a conceptual map. Okay, so you can do a project map, you can do a conceptual map, but a conceptual map is generally made when you are finished with everything. So, you know, when you are finally finished with all the coding, all the transcripts and getting some 20 themes, that is the time we finally make a conceptual map. This is very, very small mini example. It could go it could go complicated to further quite a few, you know, things. One more thing that I need to show you is, again, in Explore, you will go to Maps and you will go to something called a mind map. Now, mind maps are made when you have a theory. Like I told you in content analysis, I have a predefined theory already. Okay, so I might say that, okay, let me call it predefined theory. Okay, now this is a mind map. This is a mind map which I would take when I know that, okay, I have a theory. So I say this construct that I am exploring in these transcript is called sustainable consumption. Okay, I name it sustainable consumption, and I am now saying that, okay, now this is supposedly the parent node or the parent idea. Now I want a it says insert child. Okay, so sustainable consumption was defined through which 3 factors. So this is my main construct, or what we call the DV. Okay, dependent variable, and I am saying what are the independent variables. So those independent variables over here are called child. So this is the main construct that I was trying to make a scale for. Suppose I'm trying to make a scale for sustainable consumption. So my parent construct becomes sustainable consumption, and I right click and it says child construct. Child construct means, for example, which are the factors which are affecting it. So I say, okay, I found out a factor called money, okay, and then I can again go to this and insert another child character. What is the second factor that I found out? I found out family size, okay, and I could even do it the other way. I could right click on family size and say insert sibling. So this is the third factor, which is called emotions, okay. In money, I could further make children. So in money, further, I could say insert child idea. So in money, suppose I had in money, there were two types of factors that I found within money. Okay, one was waste of money. Okay, second was edit label. If you want to add the text, you just go right click and edit label. Second one was that people were again and again in their transcript saying that we don't want to waste money. Okay, the second thing which people said was that they had less money. Okay, so one way was that they did not have money to spend, and the other set of people was that they had money but they did not waste it. Okay, so these are the two mini concepts within money, or we can call them children of money. So now you have this whole map, you know, where you have defined. If you go on the left upside in the toolbar, you could probably show it like this, or you could show it in this format. So there are three formats in which you can show it. So here, sustainable consumption, I think this is a much more familiar format for all of you. So there is a main construct which I was studying through qualitative research, which was sustainable consumption. I found out three factors which affected in money. Further, my samples said there were two uses of money. One was that they didn't have money at all. They were short of money. And the second was that probably they had money, but they did not want to waste it. Similarly, for family size, I could further insert a child saying generations, you know, people spoke about generations, and there could be another child where I could see in when they were speaking about family size. So this is also like saying these are two codes which I clubbed together. This is also like saying I had two mini codes and I clubbed together. So there were people talking about generations. If you remember in the word count, people were talking about mother, father. So let me make this parent. So when people spoke about family, they spoke about two generations, the old generation, new generation. And when they spoke about family size, they primarily spoke about their parents being a crucial factor while doing a consumption. Okay, so today what we have done is, let me just summarize what we have done is, we have done what is exploratory research. We have done what are qualitative research types. We have done what are the inputs which can be put into qualitative research, like personal interviews, research articles, audios, videos, etc. Today we started with importing files, making a new project of NEVO, importing files into it. We went forward to coding, okay, from the transcripts we coded. We went to some activities in explore. We went to explore and we did word count. We analyzed how from word count we could make an item, or how from word count we could make a theory. We did a text search. Suppose there is, after reading the transcript, I feel that no, money is one factor which I think is there embedded, but it hasn't come out very well in the word count. So I can put it in and see whether it is an important factor for my theory, whether it's an important item or statement for my construct or not. We also did maps. Okay, so in maps, we did three different types of maps. We did a project map in which we put in variables, and then we put in files also, so that we see that is each file talking about that one variable or not. If each file, that is all the 25 respondents, are talking about that one variable, definitely it should go into a concept map. And we made a concept map where, based on what we have read in the transcripts, we say, okay, this relates to this, this relates to this, so on and so forth. And then we made something called a mind map. So in mind map, what we did is we could go with a preset theory, like in content analysis, we first make a theory and then. So I feel that sustainable consumption, these will be the factors which will affect it. And further, it could be divided into parent and child nodes and represented the way it is represented. So that will be all for today. And in the next session, that is tomorrow, I will carry on the audio and video analysis. That is the first thing I have to do. I will be adding files to these present files. So you'll have three interviews, another one audio, another one video. And at the end of all that, when I've taught you how to code audio and video, we'll again make a map. Okay, so now that one part money will not only be said by three interviewees, it will also be said by the person who was there in the audio by the video. So you will have five inputs which are talking about money. So I'll show you how to do that. We will also do a sentiment analysis, and we will take data from Twitter and social media and try and analyze that into NVivo. So that will be for the next session. And then, of course, there will be question answers, which you can share. There is a group made. So on the group, you can definitely put in any questions that you have for today. Right. So signing off for today, and I should be seeing you in the next session with something really new. Thank you so much, and goodbye.